Everyone has a story to tell, where they came from, where they're going, and where they belong. For many Pacific people in this country, their stories began with a journey. Parents or grandparents who took that first step, leaving family behind for a better future in the land of milk and honey.
Long white clouds, ancient lands, open fields, sacred grounds, bays of plenty, the bluff, the
cave. Māloi lele, welcome to this Tangata Pasifika special. We begin our journey with three tales, stories that started in the Cook Islands, in Tonga and in Niue, and ended up here in Aotearoa in the 1940s and 50s. It's a snapshot of the similarities and the differences through the eyes of two generations. In our first story, we meet Lucy and Charlotte Atinga. Lucy is a part-time careers advisor at AUT and entrepreneur with several of her own businesses. Charlotte has just finished year 13 at St. Cuthbert's College in Auckland and is contemplating her future. The journey first started in the early 1950s when Lucy's parents, Melissa Tua and Kautau Lovulu, left the Friendly Islands and came to New Zealand, initially for medical reasons.
They were happy for us to come here because they knew that their children would have a really good education. And that's a, you know, a typical thing of Pacific Island families. You want your children to do well. You want them to do better than you.
Lucy is the youngest of three children and the only one born here.
I spoke English straight away. That was probably the difference between myself and my brother and sister. When I look back now, I actually had an idyllic childhood, really. You know, I just enjoyed life here in New Zealand, just like a Kiwi did.
Just like a Kiwi, but with Tongan flavouring. Being New Zealand-born made for some interesting times for Lucy.
I could speak Tongan, but not in the sort of the high-level language they could. So when I used to go to sort of different Tongan functions as you got older, you didn't sort of feel like you were Tongan. And they sort of said, well, you're a Kiwi because you don't speak Tongan here, you know. So I guess that's when I started to have a bit of an identity crisis then, you know, yeah.
She spent all of her childhood growing up in Herne Bay. She even married locally. Lucy fell in love with and married Fred Atsinga, a New Zealand-born Samoan from just around the corner.
You hear about things about Tongan and Samoan, especially here in New Zealand. Probably not too much back in the islands, but more here, because you're living more closely. But I actually probably didn't take any notice of that, and neither did Fred, so... And they ended up together. We don't have any issues. The children, we're close to both families, and we're really lucky like that. And we all get on well. I'm the boss, and the kids go to Fred if they want something, and they always ask, have you asked your mum yet? So it's just like a normal family, really. Nothing to do with culture.
Lucy and Fred have four children. Charlotte is the baby. Growing up in a Samoan Tongan family was normal, even if English was the most convenient language.
We all have the advantage of having parents that speak English to us. We can speak English to each other. So it's not like at home we have to speak, you know, Tongan, Samoan, then at school and out in the wider community we have to speak English. So I think that would be a big difference, especially with Grandma having probably spoken Tongan more to my mum when she was younger.
The matriarch of the family is Melissa Tua. Her beloved Kautau died over 10 years ago. They bought this house in Herne Bay in the 1950s. The family still live there, although it's shared with international students. Grandma, seen here celebrating her 94th birthday last month, has played a pivotal role in helping the Tongan community and the family over six decades.
I think what I've learned from her is her patience that she has with all these people that are coming and going in her life. She's been very patient, very welcoming person. She's very generous.
I think maybe Mum's kind of learnt from that, you know, if you can help someone, do. And I think from there, that's probably where I've picked up from Mum that, you know, I like working with people and I like helping people.
When Lucy was around Charlotte's age, she became quite political and joined the Polynesian Panthers at a time where there was injustice and prejudice against Pacific people.
We were actually trying to stand up for our own rights because our parents were quite happy to be in New Zealand, happy to accept everything here. But there were certain things that were happening to us, like the Dawn raids and all those immigration issues. So no one could stand up, and it would have to be us, the first generation.
You know, I was just amazed. I you know, I couldn't believe it, and I went and researched and everything, and I thought, oh my, this is a huge thing, like, you know, and I couldn't believe that I didn't know about it.
Lucy went to school at Auckland Girls Grammar, but her daughter Charlotte has just finished at St Cuthbert's. She received a scholarship to go to the school and was one of the few Pacific students there.
I'm proud that I went to this school where, you know, you say St Cuthbert's and you think instantly just, you know, the white majority, a Balangi majority. I'm proud that I was that, you know, Tongan Samoan girl that went there, that you know, with my friends and I, we established the Samoan cultural group to go and perform at Polyfest.
Education has played a huge role in both Lucy and Charlotte's lives. The generation gap is wide, but the expectations are pretty much the same.
Yes, it wasn't until I got to high school that I started to feel that pressure. It was very subtle things like, it would be nice to be a doctor, you know, subtle things like that. You are studying when you're at school, aren't you? And they were so happy that I went to university, and then, because it was like a big day for them when I graduated, so they, you know, they felt like it was worth the trip here to New Zealand, to, you know, to leave paradise to come to here.
Charlotte is now contemplating taking a gap year, time out before going to university. It's something Lucy would never have been able to do, but not so for Charlotte.
And I said, well, you know, some people take a gap year because if they do go to university, once they start, they go right through. So you want to sort of get that kind of feeling away.
Yeah, I mean, I think I just expected that Mum would think, you know, why am I even considering that after, you know, there's, you know, the education that I've had, I just...
And is it also because I always say no?
Yeah, you know, exactly. It's my favourite answer, is no.
You're always eating, Charlotte. Go over there and sit over there.
I don't even like peanut butter. No.
The journey of Lucy and Charlotte Artinga, first and second generation Pacific daughters, is still continuing. And despite the age difference, ultimately the hopes are the same.
My expectations for Charlotte is actually to have some goals and achieve them. And whether she does it or not, I'm just happy, as long as she keeps out of trouble.
Yeah.
Really, it's just simple as that, as long as she's happy.
I think they would be sort of expectations I've had of myself, and if I had children, I would think that, you know, I want my children to grow up and be, you know, respectful, but also do something they want to do and be passionate about something.
So I'm not going to be living in an old people. I'll be living with
no,
you.
No, yeah, but Steph did tell me, my older sister,
got
Steph
that on
did
tape.
Say, you know, you're taking Mum when when you grow up.
As the youngest.
Yeah. I mean, it's not going to be a punishment or anything. But,
it sounds like.